नो
ना।
या दैट्स व्हाट इफ इट हैज बीन कम इट हैज बीन इजी. अरे ऑनलाइन
ओ बिकॉज़ अटैचमेंट आल्सो टेक्स टाइम। मेरे को एक्चुअली
हेलो.
इंटरव्यू में फोन लोड रहता है ना तीन दोस्त
सर इट इज लाइव नाउ सो वी विल बी स्टार्ट.
स्टार्ट नाउ
या इट इज लाइव ऑलरेडी यूट्यूब लाइव सो नाउ वी कैन स्टार्ट नाउ.
ओके सो कैन यू सी दिस स्लाइड
या यू गो इन अ स्लाइड मोड.
Now it is in slide mode.
Yeah, it is there. So then we'll start. Just wait. Then I'll start. Good morning, everyone. Hope you and your family are healthy and safe. I, Dr. Avinash Kumar, would like to extend a warm welcome to our today's speaker, Dr. Anil Kumar, as well as all the participants of webinar series Indian Polar and Ocean Mission, which is being hosted by National Center for Polar and Ocean Research and Autonomous Body, Ministry of Earth Sciences, to celebrate the 75th years of independence. Today is the second talk of the webinar series, Indian Endeavor in the Southern Ocean, a regime which regulates the global climate. I would like to give a brief introduction for today's speaker, Dr. Anil Kumar. He is a senior scientist and group director of Ocean and Polar Ocean Science Division of NCPOR. He obtained his master's degrees and PhD from Cochin University of Science and Technology, CUSAT. He has about 30 years of research experience in the field of estuaries, coast, and open oceans. Currently, he is responsible for planning and execution of Indian scientific expedition to Southern Ocean. Throughout his research career, he has published over 100 research papers in the national, international journals and book. He has presented more than 90 papers in a prestigious national, international symposium, seminars and conferences. Dr. Anil Kumar has an extensive fieldwork and expedition experience in the Southern Ocean, having participated more than 11 expeditions since 2004. He also served in many national, international forums and bodies, including Board of Studies of Goa University, Cochin University, SUSE, GOSIPS Committee, the Indian Meteorological Society of the Ocean Society of India, and other forums. With his brief introduction, I request Dr. Anil Kumar to take this webinar series. And I request all the participants to write their queries and any questions to the comment section we will take after his talk. Sir, please, you can start with you.
Thank you very much, Dr. for giving a nice introduction for me. Good morning to all. This talk about the Southern Ocean is a regime which regulates the global climate and what India has done in the Southern Ocean and why this region is important. These are the main topics I'm going to talk here. So, for the Southern Ocean expedition, India has started this endeavor in 2004, and first expedition was launched one of the search vessels of Ministry of Earth Sciences, that is or we Sagar Kenya. And we went up to 56 south, and enormous data and samples have been collected during this expedition to understand the preliminary what is the ecosystem functioning and processes. So after 2004, we have carried around 10 expeditions in Southern Ocean using various platforms. Second expedition 2006 and the third expedition 9, we went on academic Boris Petrov. It is a Russian vessel, a chartered vessel, and we went up to Antarctica. And on the way, we have collected a lot of samples and data. Afterwards, we have used the ministry's vessel, that is Sagar Nithi, from 2010 to 15. And from 17 onwards, we have hired a vessel from South Africa, that is the Gulhas. On this vessel, we have done around 3 expeditions. This is what the expeditions what we have carried out, the platforms what we have used to carry out this expedition. We have to understand about why we have to go there, what is the importance of this region. So most of you might be knowing that there are 3 kind of oceans, major oceans, as the Pacific Ocean, Atlantic Ocean, and Indian Ocean. So the Pacific and the Atlantic region, Southern Ocean region of the Pacific and the Atlantic, and enormous studies have been carried out. However, the Indian sector, the studies were very sparse. Why? Because from India is one of the major countries, rim countries in the Indian Ocean. And then comes South Africa, Australia, Madagascar, Mauritius. These are all coming in the Indian Ocean sector. So, inside, they have done some of the studies from Tasmania to Antarctica. And South Africa, they have done some of the studies in the Agulhas retroflexion region. Like the studies have been carried out. But what happened to the just south of India, straight for, we are going down south. What are the changes happening in this region and how it is important to the Indian climate change or the tropical Indian Ocean changes and all, how this is influencing. This is a very important thing to be addressed. For this purpose, India has taken since 2004. And I have shown you a study area in the yellow marking. This is the area what India has selected. 2 regions have been selected. One is 45 East and other one is 57 East. So there will be a question why we have selected these regions, 45 East as well as 45 to 48 East and 57 East. 48 East is above the Southwest Indian. So that region, a lot of bottom topographic influence is coming in this region to the currents and water masses, whatever moving through this region. And it is influencing the circulation and water masses. But 57 East is a flat region. That means there is not much projection in the bottom. So there is a flat region. So how it behaves there? So to compare these 2 regions, we have selected these 2. Accordingly, we have come out with some of our findings. So next slide is the significance of Southern Ocean. So how the Southern Ocean is becoming important? Because most of the students may not have gone through this importance of Southern Ocean. Why? Indian Ocean might have studied detailed way and all. But what is Southern Ocean important? That is a little bit candy about to understand about. Because getting data from Southern Ocean is very, very difficult. Plus, this region is very harsh and hostile. And going to this region data is very, very difficult. And the only option is during the summer season, you can go there and collect the data. But winter and other seasons is very difficult because of the strong winds and high what is occurring in the Southern Ocean region. So the Southern Ocean signatures of global change are more pronounced, very clear in this region compared to other regions. It is very clear. So whatever the climate change comes, it is controlling the Southern Ocean that we can see. Then interaction, biogeochemical cycles, then marine productivity, these are all very important in this region, because we don't have much idea about what is happening in this region, how it is behaving. And you know that lot of CO2, that's known as the greenhouse gases, are getting produced in the tropical regions and all. And because of burning carbon, a lot of this kind of gases are getting produced. And this is transporting through atmospheric circulation to the Southern Ocean. So from tropics to polar region, when we are going, the temperature is getting reduced, because you know that the sun, the influence is the tropical region is high. When you are going towards polar, it is less. So the temperature is getting reduced. And because of that low temperature, the gases will be absorbed more compared to the region. So the Southern Ocean is absorbing all the water CO2 is getting produced here and reaching there, and it is getting absorbed. But you know that the CO2 production is going to be in a higher level. During the recent studies, it has been addressed very properly that it is getting going up, CO2 production. So a saturation limit. So beyond that it goes, where it will go, where how it can absorb all these things. So what will happen, whatever is going there, it will be absorbed and it is coming back to the tropical region. Since it is warmer, it will get ventilated and emitted in the tropical region. So whatever we are producing and putting in the Southern Ocean is coming back. That is what is happening. And next is the nutrient. The Southern Ocean region is known as high nutrient and low chlorophyll region, because the productivity is found to be very less. Why? Because the Southern Ocean is away from the land. So the land is another source for producing the iron, as well as cobalt, zinc, and all. This is very important for productivity. So these micronutrients are not getting in this region. That is why the productivity is found to be less. Plus, this region availability is also less. And you know that the high wind is occurring in this region, because the mixer layer is going very, very deep. Mixer layer means the surface to up to some 100 meters of water, because of the impact of wind, it is getting mixed, this water for water. That is known as mixer layer. So it seems to be very high when we are going towards the polar region. So these are all the factors for the productivity is getting affected in this region. Then as I told you, CO2 is getting emitted, as well as the heat, whatever is transferred, this also getting absorbed in this region. And we are coming to the Indian Ocean. Compared to Atlantic and Pacific sector, Indian Ocean has a peculiarity that it is the northern side is land in the north. So we know, because of the differential heating, the land and the sea, there is a reversal in monsoon, southwest monsoon and northeast monsoon, because of the winter monsoon, summer monsoon, because of the wind is blowing from land to sea and sea to land. Like that, it is happening, and the monsoon changes is occurring. And then the Indian Ocean through flow, that is from the Pacific, a flow is coming, it's a warm water is coming to the Indian sector, and more warm in the sector, Indian Ocean, I can say. So, and you know that the Southern Ocean is linked with the Indian Ocean circulation. So in the Indian Ocean circulation is connected to Southern Ocean. So whatever changes is happening Southern Ocean, it is affecting the Indian Ocean. So it is very, very important to study about Southern Ocean, how it is behaving and how it is affecting the Indian monsoon, as well as Indian tropical Indian Ocean ecosystem. This is very important. That is why we have taken this ventures. Is the Southern Ocean sector, Indian sector of the Southern Ocean. But then the long-term data, whatever we are collecting, it can be used for the model studies. Model studies are very important to predict the climate, how it will be and how it will affect the system and all. So next is the major currents, what we can see in the Pacific, Atlantic and Indian Ocean. So here I can say that the three systems, current system, that is the north equatorial current and equatorial current, counter current and under current, as well as south equatorial current. These are all the major currents found in the Pacific sector, Atlantic sector, and the Indian Ocean sector. So this current is moving towards west, and whenever it reaches the western side, it is turning south, south, and it is joining in the Indian sector. I am telling now because we are talking about the Indian sector, turning south, and it is joining with the Agulhas. You can see that one Agulhas is there. Here Agulhas, this is coast of Africa. This here comes the Agulhas current. It is joining with Agulhas, going going down, and it is joining with the Antarctic circumpolar current. So Antarctic circumpolar current is the current. It is joining the Pacific, Atlantic, and Indian sector, and it is moving eastwards due to the west wind. So that is a current system connecting the all oceans. That is the Southern Ocean of Indian sector, of Southern Ocean, Pacific, and Atlantic. So in the Indian sector, it is joining with the ACC. That is circumpolar current, and moving eastwards. Again, it is joining the West Australian current, and it is coming back to India. So this circulation is happening. So whatever changes is occurring in the equatorial region as well as the Southern Ocean region, it is delayed. So currents are very important to understand about the system. So the next one is conveyor belt. So the conveyor belt, what is the conveyor belt? So conveyor belt means there is a flow of water from the polar region to the tropical region. Then again it goes to the polar region, then again it goes to the tropical region and coming back and polar region. So this is a conveyor belt is going on like this, a water circulation, the water movement is going on like this between the polar and the tropical as well as the again the polar region. So this is Arctic region, then tropic, then Antarctic region, like that in the ocean this circulation, this conveyor belt is going on. So whatever changes is occurring in this region are getting transported, and that kind of properties are getting transported. That is happening. That is what conveyor belt is doing. Then we have to understand about the nutrients. Nutrients, how nutrients means nitrate, phosphate, silicate. These are all the nutrients. All together, we are calling it as nutrients. So nutrients, when we are going down south, we can see that down south the nutrients is high. I told you it is an SNLC region, so high nutrients and low chlorophyll because of less productivity is not getting utilized. So it is the nutrients are high in this region, as well as the chlorophyll. When we are seeing towards south, it is not much productive. But from our observations and studies, we found that the CF region, that is the subtropical frontal region, that is tropics, then subtropics, and subantarctic and polar region. I will tell you in the next slide and all what is subtropics, subantarctic and polar region. When we are going towards this region, the productivity is coming to be less. So these are the ocean fronts. Ocean fronts means how the fronts are getting formed. This is especially when we are going from the tropics, the subtropical water masses, it is moving towards south. And from the south, subantarctic water masses are coming towards north. So these two water masses are getting mixed at 40 degrees south. So because of this mixing, subtropical surface water is high saline and high temperature. However, subantarctic surface water is low saline as well as low temperature. These two water masses are getting mixed, and at that mixing, the temperature drastic change or reduction in temperature and salinity occurring. This region is known as a SNL region. So first we are observing in the subtropical region, it is known as subtropical front. Again we are going south, another region will come, that is known as the subantarctic frontal region. Again we are going, when we are going towards south, temperature is more important, and because of the change in temperature we are calling it the frontal region. So again comes subantarctic front, then comes polar front, then again we are going south, subantarctic what is the southern ACC, that is Antarctic circumpolar current front, then comes the southern boundary. These are all the various fronts what we can observe in the Southern Ocean region. So what is water mass? Water mass means it is having a characteristics of particular temperature and particular salinity. So wherever it goes, this water mass from south to north or north to south, it will keep its characteristics. So whenever it loses its characteristics, we say that the water mass has not reached there. So whenever we are collecting the data or samples, we will measure the salinity and temperature. These are the major two parameters based on which we can address a water mass. And now oxygen is also one of the important parameters to address about a water mass. So these are all the major parameters addressing the water mass. And when we are going to, I am mainly telling about the Southern Ocean water masses. When we are going towards south, subtropical surface water comes, then further south, down south, subantarctic surface water comes, then Antarctic surface water comes, then subtropical mode water, that is the subtropical region which is getting formed. And the Antarctic intermediate water and circumpolar deep water and the Antarctic bottom water. These are all the major water masses what are in this Southern Ocean region. Then again the floods. I told you about floods means a drastic change in temperature and salinity occurs. That region is known as a flood region. So different floods, Agulhas return flood, southern subtropical flood, subantarctic flood, and the north side and south side. Then polar front 1, polar front 2, that is south and north, like that we have divided. Then the Antarctic circumpolar current front, then the southern boundary. Then in Indian sector of Southern Ocean, there is a particular nature for this frontal sector is occurring, or frontal region is occurring. From this figure, actually, in the Indian sector, there is two major controlling factors are there for the Antarctic circumpolar current when it is moving towards east. Number one is the Weddell gyre. Weddell gyre is from the 30 east up to 30 east, one big circulation is there. It is known as the Weddell gyre. So if it comes up to 60 south, above 60 south it comes. So because of this Weddell gyre circulation, whatever the ACC moving towards north and when versus the Weddell gyre, it is moving towards south. That you can see in this figure, the fronts are moving towards south from east to west. So it is moving towards south in the Indian sector of Southern Ocean, especially because of the impact of Weddell gyre plus the southwest Indian ridge. Because I told you that bottom topography. These two are influencing for the meandering of means it is moving movement towards south is mainly controlling by these two factors in the Indian sector. Then why we went to the Indian sector of Southern Ocean to understand about the main focus of the study is role and response of Southern Ocean to the regional and global climate variability. This is the main focus. But to address this focus, we require an enormous data set. Then only we can a decadal change for the climate, how it affects and all. It requires a lot of data sets. For us, we have a lot of constraints to get the data from Southern Ocean. So we are getting only in the wind summer season and other season, we cannot go there to collect the data. Only we can depend on the satellite data. But now we are coming out with new techniques to get the data during the other season. That I will discuss in the later slide. So the question to be addressed from this study is, how do the atmospheric and oceanic dynamics in the Southern Ocean affect the tropical weather and climate? How the physical process and atmospheric aerosols and other trace gases are modulated by biological pump, biogeochemistry, and vice versa? These are the two major questions to be addressed after studying about the Southern Ocean processes. So, our studies mainly concentrated on two aspects. We have collected data to address the two aspects. One is the interaction and anthropogenic aerosols over the ocean. And next is the interaction between physical, chemical, and biological elements across ACC and their role in carbon sequestration and biogeochemistry. And there is one platform known as SOOS, that is Southern Ocean Observation System, that is an international body, and from this body has given lot of questions to be addressed to study the Southern Ocean. So two major questions we have selected from this. And one is, how do the changes in the Southern Ocean meridional overturning pressure and the water masses affect the thermohaline variability, CO2 dynamics, acidification rate, and biogeochemistry of the Southern Ocean, and which can affect the regional global climatic variabilities? And does the ocean and sea ice interaction in the coastal region of Southern Ocean will affect the water masses, and that is what bottom water masses or other water masses, whether this kind of changes will affect the water masses. These two are the major questions we have selected from the tools to study in connection with the observation. Yeah, the how we are implementing the Southern Ocean expedition. This is an important thing for other institutions to participate in this expedition. So planning, coordination, and execution of the Southern Ocean expedition are first we will do during May, June, or we will put an advertisement in the website and journal and newspaper. And scientific proposals will be invited, and they can submit the proposal accordingly, various institutions. And the international, the internal and the external review, first we will do the internal review. And external review, we will select the external experts and internal experts, and the external review and internal review will be carried out this on this what proposals received. And after receiving the suggestions given by the committee to the PAs to make corrections accordingly. And after the proposals are corrected, they will be called and they have to give a presentation in front of the review committee. And based on that, the review committee will recommend the proposal, and the proposals, we will consolidate all the proposals together, and it will be sent to the Honorable Minister. So through Ministry of Earth Science, we will send to Ministry of Earth Science, and from there, the approval from the minister will be taken to implement the expedition. This is the main different step what we are taking to implement this expedition. And then we will do the logistics arrangement from where we are launching the expedition. Usually our expeditions are launching Mauritius. Till date, we have launched all the expeditions in Mauritius, because Mauritius is 57 East, yes, 57 East. So one of our samples is 57 East. So from Mauritius, we will collect the 57 East all samples. So 10 years of changes, what is happening in this region, you will get an idea. That is what we have selected from Mauritius implementation expedition. And this 62 plus or minus 5 days. This usually it takes up the endurance of this vessel and as well as the implementation of that. Then interpretation of results and the other data samples collected from various expeditions will be done accordingly. Then this is what the latest expedition what we made. That is in 2020, the Indian Scientific Expedition to Southern Ocean, that is ISPSO. And this has been from Jan 8 to March 2020, on board chartered vessel SA Abul Haas. We have implemented the last expedition in 2020. So the track is shown here. And the track, you can see the difference in colors in the track. Why it has? Because we have given the temperature changes in the track. You can see the right side, the scale. So temperature going down while going towards south. When it reaches down, very down south, in the coastal regions of Antarctica, temperature is very, very less in this region. From our study, one of the initial what we found is that, as I told you, that in the Indian sector, we have selected two transects. One is 45 to 48 east, and the other one is 57 east. So there is a meandering of the ACT, which is a Abul Haas return front plus subtropical front plus Abantartic front. It is known as ACT core. It has been defined as an ACT core. This ACT core is getting shifted by 2 to 3 degrees towards south when we are going towards east. That is what we are getting in first findings from the ocean study. And what is happening, as I have already informed, there are two risks. One is the wildfire, and the second one is the topographic influence. So another phenomenon is happening in the notion is eddy. What is eddy? Eddies means, I told that the subantarctic and subtropical water masses, subantarctic and subtropical water masses, they are getting mixed. In this mixing region, lot of circulation, that kind of things are happening. This circulation is known as eddies. So different reasons are there for eddies. Maybe because of the impact of wind or influence of water topography, or as the mixing of water masses, and different reasons are there. So the subtropical front, I told you, it is a very dynamic region, and the eddy formation is very, very high in this region. And the important thing is that in the Indian sector, the Southern Ocean, I told you that the South Equatorial Current comes and joins with the Angular Current, and it's moving towards south, and it is turned, and it is joining with the ACC and moving towards east. Wherever it turns, it is known as the Angulhas retroflexion, and that is down south of Africa. And when this retroflexion happens, there are a lot of meandering or eddies are opening in this region. That is also getting transported towards the subtropical region in the Indian sector. So there are a lot of eddies are getting formed. So there are two types of eddies. One eddy is known as cold core eddy. The cold core eddy means, you can see that clockwise circulation is occurring in the Southern Ocean. Clockwise circulation. So, anti-clockwise circulation is occurring in the Southern Ocean. So, anti-clockwise circulation, the water mass from the subsurface level, it will from around circulation. So, the cold water is coming up. So, the core is cold. So, around the surrounding is not very cold. But the core, the center region is cold. So it is known as a cold core eddy. So it is a divergence is happening. So coming up as a divergence. So the second one is the warm core eddy. So warm core eddy means it is the water is coming there and it is converging down. So it is coming up, the warm water is coming and it is going down. So it is known as warm core eddy. So cold core eddy and warm core eddy, these are the two phenomena occurring in this region. So we have studied some of the our studies we have concentrated in this region to address about how the eddies behave and how it is affecting the productivity as well as the changes occurring in the solution and community changes and all. These are have been addressed based on this eddy study. And another one is that the spatial variation in the community structure. So phytoplankton and zooplankton are the major plankton what we are finding in this region. So you may be going about the 10th standard, 11th standard. We have studied about plankton, water plankton, phytoplankton is there, primary productivity. That is there. And others are depending on phytoplankton. But they will be eating phytoplankton. So phytoplankton, primary productivity is mainly doing the plankton. There are different types of phytoplankton, prokaryotes, flagellates, diatoms. So how this varies from the tropics to polar regions, how it is varying. So that is what is showing here. So the red one is the prokaryote. That is mainly found in the tropical region. When we are going towards south, the subtropical regions, it is dominating by flagellates, another kind of phytoplankton. And when because this is very dynamic region, flagellates can survive any kind of condition. That is why it is getting dominated in the region. When we are going more down south, we are getting diatoms. This is what the changes community, what we are observing in the Southern Ocean studies. Next is one of the about phytoplankton and zooplankton. Then zooplankton, what we observed, the biomass, the quantity of zooplankton, what we got is STF, that is subtropical friend, subantarctic friend, then polar friend, and Antarctic friend. So polar friend is a maximum abundance we are getting in the polar region compared to the other central regions. Then is a variables found. These are different types of zooplankton, what we observed in the Southern Ocean study from our observation. Yeah. So our salient findings. So a lot of findings we made because we have published around more than 100 papers in well-reputed international and high impact journals and in different conferences and symposiums and also. We have presented these papers, and today I'm telling 3-4 findings. One is the zones of sink and ventilation of CO2 have been identified. 52 south, is a sink, and the other is 45 south. These two regions we identified. And CO2 brought to, I have told you, tropical regions where water mass is from polar region. Water is going there, is coming back to the tropical regions. So that is what is occurring here. And the non-sea salt aerosols. So aerosols, non-sea salt aerosols are found in the Southern Ocean region. Then comes, glacier melting. Glacier means in the Southern Ocean, a lot of ice is getting deposited in this, the land regions and all, at this glacier. And then comes the, there we know the continental shelf is coming. And in that, the shelf, ice shelf, we can say that. In the Antarctic region, we can say ice shelf. In the, when we are coming to tropical, we continental region, there it is with ice, it comes. So ice shelf, we can say. So whenever the warm water goes to this region, it is getting melted. So melting means fresh water is coming. So it is getting added to the system, and the water masses are getting freshness. More fresh it will become, water mass. So the entire water mass become fresh means the entire system will be affected, productivity will be affected, and the ecosystem will be affected accordingly. So the community changes, lot of things will happen because of this. So this is a major point to be addressed, how much it is getting freshened, how much it is freshening is happening with this water mass, and what could be the reason for that. And the phytoplankton group side, and I have already discussed about you, what are the phytoplankton we are seeing from tropical to subtropical and polar region. Then this the observation, what we did, in the nutrient, inorganic carbon, energy, hydrodynamics we have studied, and isotopes, studies, and iodides, and chlorophyll size fraction, a lot of things we have studied from this samples that we have collected, and these are the various studies what we carried out in the system of Southern Ocean. Based on that, we have come out with new findings from the Indian. So these are some of the, what is that I can say about the equipment. First one is the CTD, that is not conductivity, temperature, depth measurement. You can hear me properly.
CTD, yes, sir, it is
okay. CTD means the conductivity, temperature. It is okay. Okay, thank you. Conductivity, temperature, and depth. Conductivity, you know, so from the conductivity, we are measuring salinity. Salinity, then temperature. And then the depth. Depth is the pressure. These are the three main factors controlling the changes in the Southern Ocean picture. So these three measurements we are using the CTD. When this going down, this instrument is going down. This instrument is going down. So we will get a profile in the monitor. So we measure timely measurement. Online get what is the temperature at each depth, how it behaves, and any how, what are the changes is happening like that. Immediately gives information. And what are the things connected with this is known as nesting body. Why this has been connected? Because we want to collect the sample from different depths, from surface. The surface we are collecting using bucket. But while going down at 5 meters, 10 meters, and 15 meters, different depth, this bottle will be closed whenever it reaches at a particular depth. So suppose 15 meters, one bottle will be closed. We have two bottles. To be closed, we will give the message from the deck. Give the message, then two bottles will be closed. Accordingly, we can collect the samples from different depths. So different depth samples will be collected. So accordingly, we can understand about the water column, what are the changes are happening. And because the temperature and salinity changes, how it is affecting, how the productivity or how the community structure is getting changed. So this, how the ecosystem behaves, these are all information we can study using this. This is another major equipment what you are using here. And XCTD, XCTD is a probe. So it is also a CTD only, but it is expendable. That means can be disposable. And once we are using the probe, that is, it will go up to 1000 meters, it will give the data. Afterwards, it will go. We cannot get it back. But the information up to 1000 to 1100 meters, we will get the information about temperature and salinity in the XCTD. And that's Then next is the MPN, that is multiple internet, which is using to cast the super lantern at different depth. From up to 500 meters or 2000 meters, we can use this net to collect super lantern at different levels. So we can understand about what kind of, I have shown in one of the slides, different species in the super lantern. Which species is dominating in which region, which depth, like that, we can mainly study with this MPN. Then comes the bongo net. Bongo net is using, this is the bongo net. This is the phytoplankton studies mainly we are using the bongo net. Then comes the vine wheel graph. This is mainly the sediment collection. So sediment collections, this is using from the surface sediments can be collected. This will be opened, first it will go. When it reaches the bottom, the sediment, it will be, we will give a mechanism and it will be closed. So surface sediments will be collected in the vine wheel graph. Then comes the coral, sediment cores, different kind of sediment cores are there. That the corals are there. The sediment, the coral means there is gravity coral, is there, piston coral, is there. Different type of corals are there. So these corals will be used to collect the sediment in the depth, that is up to some 6 meters of sediment thickness. What is the thickness of sediment? With this core, it will be collected. It will go and penetrate in the sea bottom, and the core will be collected in the coral. And the pipe will be there instead, and the coral comes up, we can take the sediment. Why is the sediment not required? Because paleoclimatic studies, that different billions of years back, what was the condition of the climate condition, we can get it from the below depths and all. That means the core, the different depths gives different stages of climate changes, we can understand using this course. That is very important. Then another thing what we have done here is the moving of equipment. So I told you that our data collections and all, we are doing in summer season, and the winter seasons and spring and all, we cannot make collections in the Southern Ocean because of its behavior. It's very, very rough during the season. So what we will do, we are doing, is we are putting some instruments for a period of 1 year at one position. It will be hanged at that position up to some 4,500 meters, it will be hanged there. Attaching different sensors in that for temperature, salinity, current, dissolved oxygen, and nutrients. Different sensors will be collected in that, and even sediment collection. What are the sediment floating in the water? It will be trapped in the sediment trap. It will be collected. These kind of things will be done, and it will be after 1 year. This data we will take this back, and this data will be stored, and the samples will be stored, and again it will be put there, and again the next 1 year or 2 years it can go like that. So when their season, all seasons data will be collected using the mooring equipment. That is very important to understand about the behavior of a system in all the seasons, how it behaves. This is very important study. That is what the future studies we are planning to do. And this is one of the vessel, that is SA Agulhas, that is chartered vessel. And the team members are sitting there. They have gone in, 2017, 18. So we are during that time, our High Commissioner at Mauritius has visited our vessel, and we have explained about why we came there and what is the planning and all we have done. And afterwards, the President of Mauritius also has visited our vessel, and we have been invited there, and we went there. And a lot of collaborations we made with other scientists and all based on this expedition. Plus, other things that floats, two types of floats we have floated and deployed in that Indian Ocean, Southern Ocean. One is Argo floats. These floats are mainly Argo floats. When we are putting these Argo floats at one particular location, it will it will go down up to 2,000 meters. And while it is going down, it collects all the data. And through the surface, through the currents and all, it will move accordingly. And when after some 10 days and all, it will come up. While going down and coming up, whatever data is salinity, temperature, such kind of chlorophyll data, it will be collected. And while it is reaching the surface, it will transmit the data. And through satellites, we can get in the land, we can get the data. Accordingly, this will be transmitting the data. So, and there 5 years to 10 years, it can, this data can be collected using this Argo. Every edition, we are using this Argo cloud to understand about the Southern Ocean history, what is happening in the Southern Ocean. Like that, the Scripps Institute of Oceanography also joined with us to put the SOCOM floats in the Southern Ocean. And one of the expeditions, they have also come to put the SOCOM floats. These are all the important things to understand about the unknown areas of Southern Ocean, whether where we cannot go using a ship. That is very, very important. These are all some of our achievements, what we made till date based on this expedition. So I have told you that more than 100 papers and seminars we have, and 11 PhDs have been awarded from this study, and dissertation work. So many, I think you may be knowing about how many people are coming here for dissertation studies, MSc dissertation studies like that. So many people are coming here, and the PhD students also, so many are joining here in this group. And now I think now around 15 PhDs are in progress. That also will come out another 2-3 years. And now we are 3 special issues we have published in Current Science and Deep Sea Research in 2015 and 20 we have published. And now one book is in progress about the Southern Ocean. And we have got one project from European Union that is known as CRISIS, that Climate Relevant Interaction and Feedback. This is the project what we got from the European Union. That will be, that project will be started from the next expedition onwards. And we have membership in GoShip, SUS, SCAR, and all. So future plan. So this may be important for the students and the other institute. If they are planning to join with the Southern Ocean program, they can understand about this, and they can also come out with some of the projects which can which can contribute for this ideas and all like that can come. So our future plan, gap areas, wherever the observations are less and all, we will be doing more observations, spatial and temporal, time-wise as well as space-wise, like that we'll be making. And modeling studies are very important for the Southern Ocean. So we have already started with the modeling studies. And the institute of observations using mooring, Argo, because of the propeller, glider, and ships like that. Glider, I'll tell you the next one or two slides. I'm having that. I'll tell you what it is. And the satellite observations and modeling studies and international national collaborations and capacity building, then their capacity how to use time. That also we are doing. And it's one of the important water mass. I told you about the water mass. This aspect we are going to study in the future. Antarctic bottom mass, Antarctic bottom water formation. This is a major water mass. Two water masses are very major in the Indian system. I mean, in the Southern Ocean system, that is Antarctic intermediate water and deep water, circumpolar deep water. These two water masses are mainly controlling the, we can say that the Southern Ocean, I mean, Antarctic zone, that region mainly controlling this by these two water masses. And this Antarctic bottom water is getting produced in this region because of the mixing between the modified circumpolar deep water. It is coming from the north, that is North Atlantic. It is coming from the deep water, is coming from north. When it comes to the Antarctic region, it goes up and it is goes up and it sinks and it is mixed with other water masses, and like cold dense shelf water and all, it is getting mixed and it forms the Antarctic bottom water. That is what is showing here. So this water studies about this water mass is very important, and we will be concentrating on this study and how it affects the ecosystem. That will be concentrated in the future study. This is the important thing, that how the circumpolar deep water getting affects the ice shelf in this region. So we can say that when the easterly wind, that is the wind coming from the east, that is easterly winds are very weak in this region, then the circumpolar deep water is warm. When it comes, because you know that because of the water masses, you know, the global warming phenomenon is going on. So all the system is getting warming up. So this is affecting the Southern Ocean system also. So in the warm circumpolar deep water, it comes when the wind is very weak, like, though it will be a sloping, upward slope it gets, and it goes towards the very near to the coast, and the ice shelf region it reaches, and it melts the ice. So what happens, the ice is melting, though the fresh water will come. So it will add up. So more water will be, fresh water is coming means Anadic water water cannot be formed because it requires a particular salinity and temperature to form the anadic water water. So more pressure water is adding, it cannot be formed. So whenever the warm circumpolar deep water reaches to the ice shelf and all, formation of anadic water water is getting affected and it is getting reused and it is affecting the entire ecosystem. But if the stronger westerly winds are coming, so that the sloping is downward and it cannot go to the shelf region and melting is not happening there. So the the sea ice formation is happening in the region. Whenever sea ice forms, ice forms, it will eject the salt. Whenever ice forms, because ice is fresh, you know that. So whenever ice forms, it will eject whatever salt in that. You know the ocean is with salt water only. Whenever ice forms, it ejects salt. So in the southern region, whenever the Antarctic region is a lot very cold region. So whenever ice forms, the salt comes out. And that is not a brine rejection. It comes down and it forms the shelf water. That is the high saline shelf water. So this water will be formed, and accordingly, this water will mix with the anadic circumpolar deep water and forms the anadic bottom water. This is what is happening. So these are two main reason why it is not getting formed. Why it is formed? Another plan what we are planning to do in the future studies, as I have informed you, the mooring. So two types of mooring we are planning. One is in the coastal region. The coastal region we will be mooring for a period of 1 year, and afterwards again it will be extended for 2 years based on the data collection and all. So it will be under ice mooring. So our mooring system, so under ice means it will go down and it will keep, because ice formation will be there in the winter. It cannot come up, so it will be rest under the ice. Due to the buoyancy and all, we can adjust that. Techniques are there. It will rest under the ice, and whenever ice melts in the summer season, it will come up and it will transfer the data. That is what is the coastal mooring. But in the open ocean mooring, this is the understand about the air flux studies, changes in air flux and all. So we are using this mooring system in the open ocean. Open ocean means it will be mooring different. Sensors will be attached to that, as I already told you, and it will collect the data for 1 year, 2 years, and in that also the atmospheric data and transmission can be done online. But the deeper depths and all data will be stored. When the we are going for the next time, we can collect it and take the data storage unit and another one. So the data will get during that period. Like that, we can do that. And this is one of the proposed profiler mooring. Profiler mooring means in the usually it is in the coastal region. Whenever we are attaching a profiler in the in the wire, it will go up and down and it makes the measurement. So the entire up and down up to some 300, 400 meters. Whenever we are going very close to the coast and all, depth will be decreased. So up to 1000 meters also. Like that, we can make the profiler observation. This is also another plan in future. And this is the a glider. I told you, glider means we can program the glider and we can put it in the water. As per our programming, it will go. If you are programming from Mauritius, we are programming up to southern 65 degrees south, means it will go down up to 200 to whatever we are giving, 1000. Now 6000 meters also gliders are there. It can go down and coming up again, going down like that. It will go and it will collect the data like that. It will go there and observations it will make and it will come back. So wherever we want to take it back, we can accordingly plan it and go there and collect it back. So the entire data can be stored. Like that, it can be done. That is a glider observation. Why we are going for this observation? Because the ship-based observations are very difficult because the ice formation is there. We cannot go to these regions and collect the data. That is why we are depending on this kind of plan. So this is another technique. This is seal is another one animal what we are finding in the southern ocean region. Now a lot of countries are using this technique to collect the data. So we can attach the sensors on its head. Seals have a habit of coming in the station and it means the coast and it will take rest. By that time we can put some anesthesia or something like that on it, and it will be and we can put this fix the sensors and leave it, and it will go in the water. Wherever it goes, it gives the data, will be transmitted like that. And like that, we can get, or whenever it comes from other coast, we can get it, the data. Like that, it can be done. So using the tagging of seeds with sensors is another technique to cause the data. And studies, I already told that the modeling studies are very important, and whatever data what we have collected till date will be used to come out with a proper model to address the future, how it will change, how the Southern Ocean will change by the last 10 years, how it changed, and the next 10 years, how it changed. Accordingly, predictions can be made. So this is very important study. So this is also, you know, that in the new system, this microplastics are very, very, very dangerous. And it is in the ocean system also, microplastics are getting deposited. And what is happening, microplastics will sink. Up to a density level, it will come. You know what is density? So up to a density level, it will come. I think it will sustain there. So whatever species or community is coming there, it may go inside it, and it will get affect the community. So this is a very dangerous thing, microplastics. So we have already started the studies in the Southern Ocean region also, how it affects, how much microplastics are getting deposited. This is also another some of the another study what we are planning in the future. Yeah, deep into it. Okay, thank you. I think you have heard properly what I explained. This is our one of our visit in the last minute. That is the Bharati station, new station.
Thank you, sir. Thank you so much for your wonderful presentation, sir.
Thank you.
I think it's introduced us for the youngest ocean of the planet. I believe everyone had a good time and learned something new through this virtual platform. And now it's a questions time. So I can see there's some couple of questions has been asked. So I'll take one or two questions. That is, has anyone has measured the carbon dioxide flux for the ventilation region, that is 45 to 52 degrees south? What is the surface? Yes. What is the surface CO2 concentration? And third question, is there any sediment core raise from this ventilation region?
Yeah, these are all very important questions because CO2 emission is very, very important. So this is actually, this CO2 studies are mainly doing by the Indian Institute of Science. So one group from Indian Institute of Science, they have joined with the Southern Ocean group, and they are addressing these issues. From their studies only, we understood about the ventilation, where it is happening in the 52 and how 45 and how the sink is happening in the 52 south. This is a major study carried out by the. So they have studied about the CO2 in the surface as well as the deeper depths, how it goes, how the changes are coming. So if you want more details about this, I can definitely go get a touch with him and get the information.
Yeah.
And second question is sediment course.
Yeah.
Sediment cores. We have collected the sediment cores from the subtropical regions also, and where the ventilation is happening. And now the some of the studies are addressing about how it is affecting the climate changes are happening by the millions of years. That also has been addressed. And I think our publications have come about that, and you can refer to the publications to get an idea about it.
And the next question is. Also, from same Dr. Valiyur Rama, he has asked that, is there any plan to extend the sampling in the Weddell Sea for Antarctic water formation? Hello. I think it's connection issues there. Hello, is it audible? I think due to the bandwidth, I think this connection has been discontinued. We can take this question in the later stage. So now I will be just conclude this session. I really thanks to all the attendees and hope to see all you all again on the 17th, 13th of the May. That is the third talk of this webinar. There will be going to talk about that Indian research on the Arctic region. So I think by the time, let's strive to stay home, stay safe, and save life. Have a good day and wonderful day. I think we will meet on the next talk on the 13th May. Thank you.